Your Excellencies, Graces, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for this opportunity to try to present and briefly present and document with figures some practices we are doing as UNFPA, United Nations Population Fund, in supporting and responding to the refugee migrants crisis along their route in the Balkan countries. I will try to be brief. Not much on the introduction. We heard a lot of figures. This one is already outdated because the reality is going faster than we can capture in the figures. Nevertheless, some numbers are still compelling. Of course, we heard that most of these people, tens of thousands of people, do not want to stop along the route. They want to go as fast as possible towards the destination countries. Those countries that they are crossing through are emerging from economic crisis. On the Balkans, they are emerging from a recent war, still building their statehood, including the legislation on migration, the legislation on addressing violence, and the inter-country cooperation. Therefore, currently the situation on the transit points in between the countries, it's painful and sometimes chaotic, with thousands of people having to walk long distances, wait for hours in poor shelter or muddy fields. And the situation verges on the unbearable, especially for women and children. The protracted conflict, ongoing violence and security, reduced education and livelihood opportunities, and uncertain future in countries of the origin, fueling this mass displacement. As a result, whole families are on the move, including increased numbers of women and children, which make now up to 42% of the total population fleeing, with elderly people, people with disabilities, and unaccompanied separated minors. Refugees and migrant women and girls face specific challenges and protection risks during their transit, including family separation, psychological stress and trauma, health complications, particularly for pregnant women, physical harm and injuries. The language barriers and cultural factors combined with the intention of asylum seekers to move towards the transit countries as quickly as possible complicate the efforts of the humanitarian actors to provide support. Many women and girls are fleeing conflicts where they have been already submitted to systematic rights violation, including bombardment of civilian areas, killings and disappearance of family members, sexual and gender-based violence. Many have been repeatedly displaced. Some have suffered already violence, exploitation, and abuse while seeking asylum. Women often serve, however, as the main caretakers for children and elderly members of the families who are moving on, and this further increases their need for protection and support. In addition, the power relation that refugees and migrants have with their smugglers further reinforces the risk. The risk of sexual and gender-based violence is aggravated by the lack of safe shelter, time limitation, and language barrier to prevent women and girls from seeking protection and assistance. UNFPA does try to address the situation in cooperation with the governments and with the other UN agencies. But we have to admit that the international community and the national authorities were caught by surprise and unprepared for such a large number of people, and this humanitarian response began scaling up only mid-2015 and focused on supporting the government response to the emergency needs. In this context, UNFPA joined the other UN agencies, especially UNHCR, and includes assistance to all refugees and migrant women and girls without distinction to their present or future legal status. As this population is highly mobile, sometimes spending less than a day in the countries that they are crossing through, it is likely that individuals or families on the move may receive assistance from UNFPA and the other organizations in different countries at several points along the route. with UNHCR leading the response, UNFPA and other UN agencies are coordinating the response, and even the figures that you are using for planning our support, it's based on the UNHCR estimates. The main priority that UNFPA tries to address is providing emergency and life-saving assistance, focusing on delivering culturally sensitive, minimal sexual and reproductive health services to refugees and migrant women and girls, including to address the gender-based violence. And the outcome of our intervention is to increase the availability and accessibility and acceptability of those services. The first pillar of UNFPA intervention refers to increased access to sexual and reproductive health, including gender-based violence-related services delivery to refugees and migrants through augmented provision of mobile services, reinforced provision of drugs and equipment. We have procured 5 mobile clinics, 2 for the government of Macedonia to serve at the entry and the exit points for the country, 2 for the government of Serbia, and 1 for the Malteser order in Hungary, which provides mobile support, mobile and flexible support, both in Croatia and Slovenia as well. The next pillar is to respond to gender-based violence and to create appropriate services to be provided through the mobile clinics, but also through the existing services in the country. I would like to stress the fact that gender-based violence is a concept insufficiently recognized and addressed in the countries of transit, even for domestic victims. Therefore, we hear often that there is no cases because we don't have reports, but there is no reports because there is no services. Therefore, recent missions have documented the concrete cases of this kind of abuses, and we try to cooperate with the other UN agencies in drafting and having the governments on board in setting standard operation procedures for the victims of gender-based violence. As these women spend sometimes days or even hours in the country, they may deny access to services in a particular transit country. Therefore, I think our presence today may be a good opportunity to think on a network to refer the cases throughout the transit and up to the target countries. Gender-based violence may seem not an important and life-saving or life-threatening situation, but as the war in the Balkans shows us, the consequences, the long-term consequences of such violence is the most difficult to deal with. Because not only that one victim of gender-based violence, of sexual violence, is too much, and it has devastating impact on the life of the victim, but also it's a shame for the family, a shame for the community, a shame for the country. And this shame is going towards generations and increases the retaliation and diminish the possibility for reconciliation later on. It also, it goes unpunished. It creates the impression for the perpetrators that this is the way to live, and it may have impact on the country of destination for these people. Not only that we try to provide services, but we try also to train service providers in the countries of transit. As said, the concept of gender-based violence and sexual violence is not sufficiently known and addressed in the countries of transit, and we need to sensitize the law enforcement, but also even the health sector to provide these services. And last but not the least, also we need coordination, we need networking, and hopefully this meeting will be one more step towards coordination. Thank you very much for your time and attention. Thank you.